Welcome everyone to tonight's special edition of Culture Conversations during Family History Month. I'm David Morrow, Los Angeles-based entertainment attorney, genealogist, and your host this evening. I'm also proud to serve as a member of NGS's Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion Committee. Culture Conversations is a platform where we explore the rich intersections of history, culture, and genealogy through engaging discussions with distinguished guests. We uncover the diverse tapestry of our shared past, embracing the stories of people, places, art, food, film, and technology. Which leads me to today's guest, Ashlee Davis, JD, Global Head of Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion for Ancestry.com. Ashlee brings over 15 years of experience in diversity, civil rights, and strategic leadership. Her professional journey spans across private sectors, nonprofits, and even the executive branch of the U.S. government, where she served under the Obama administration. During her time in the administration, she worked as a senior advisor for civil rights, as well as the director of the National LGBT Rural Summer Series, an initiative aimed at connecting marginalized communities with essential resources like food security, housing, and youth empowerment. In her current role at Ancestry, Ashlee leads the charge in shaping a global strategy for diversity, equity, and inclusion, ensuring that voices from diverse backgrounds are heard and represented, both within the organization and in the tools and resources Ancestry provides to its users. She collaborates with product and marketing teams to create inclusive experiences that allow everyone to explore and connect their family stories. So before we dive into today's conversation, I like to set some guidelines for our discussion. There won't be an open Q&A during the conversation, but you're welcome to submit your questions through the chat box and we'll address them at the end. When we get to the Q&A portion, please ask respectful, thought-provoking questions that focus on the ideas presented rather than personal opinions or attacks. Now, let's get into it. Welcome, Ashlee. How are you doing?
I'm good. Hey, David, how are you? Good evening.
Good.
My side of the world. Good afternoon to you.
Right. Yeah. Well, we're happy to have you and thank you for taking time to meet with us. As you know, we're an organization of genealogists and I think 100% of us probably use your platform. And so, you know, with that in mind, my first question to you is, you know, in your role at Ancestry, it focuses on diversity, equity, inclusion. How do you see DEI intersecting with genealogy, particularly in terms of uncovering diverse and underrepresented histories?
Yeah, thank you. I don't want to begin without first just acknowledging expressing my gratitude, David, to you, to the entire DEI committee and the entire NGS family and team as well. I'm here certainly as not just one leaf on the big tree here of Ancestry, but as a footprint of several hundred, if not almost 1,400 employees around the world. And you probably would get a similar answer from just about all of us, believe it or not, because when we think about the intersection of DEI and genealogy, you will hear us like say the phrase storytelling is important, but more than anything, we believe that our mission to empower journeys of personal discovery to enrich lives has to see no bounds. It has to realize no contours that can't be overcome, because everyone deserves the right to leave that legacy, that story for someone else to pick up, to be inspired, to be informed. And so we really take seriously the opportunity to help our customers embrace their role as family storytellers. And we're working to provide everyone with more granular DNA community results and greater access to public records. I love anytime someone tells me, look, I'm already familiar with Ancestry. I've clicked in, I keep clicking, I've got it on my phone. That's music to my ears. Usually I ask two questions. One, what's working well for you? And what would you wish wound up that we would do one day? Because that helps us, meaning our entire company, innovate and iterate with everyone in mind. And, you know, we have over 3.6 million paying subscribers, 25 million non-subscribers visit our website every month, and 131 million family trees with 16 billion people in them. We've got a footprint that is important, and it's hard to measure in just mere numbers because it's family stories that offshoot from that too. And so I can't tell you more than anything. I'd say this is the greatest privilege of my life. I've had some pretty cool jobs, but the opportunity to work at Ancestry and to connect the history and remind people DEI at its fundamental, very most foundational elements is about great storytelling, authentic engagement, and getting people to think beyond what they see right in front of them. There is something that motivates you. There's a reason why, David, you became an attorney. There's a reason why you're passionate about genealogy. It's not just you on your own. There's someone behind you and beyond you as well. And so we unlock those discoveries every single day. It's pretty cool.
So, when we think about your role, I know that it's both internal and external. Can you tell us a little bit about what you do internally as far as do you have an impact on hiring practices and employment retention? And like, what does success look like to you internally, and externally?
Yeah, I'll start. Let's start internally. We've done a lot of work, my team cross-functionally with other teams to ensure that our colleagues understand the representation matters. We hear that as a buzzword, but it's not just something that looks good on a t-shirt. We know that diversity in our workforce allows us to innovate, that leads us to thrive in spaces where we have varying perspectives and backgrounds at the table. And the kind of frustrating piece to this, David, is that a lot of spaces have created really attractive phrases and mottos, but haven't really backed that up with commitments that they can measure over time. We launched our organizational goal, our drive to 45 by 2025, in order to hold ourselves accountable to achieving our DEI goals, to remove barriers to success, to identify and mitigate bias. And by the way, when I say bias, I also had to just slow down and get everyone on board to acknowledge if you have a brain, you have bias. It doesn't matter how well-intentioned you are, that you come from good stock, that you're hardworking. If you are thinking and blinking on this planet Earth, there's an ounce or two or more of bias, which means it carries with you. It shows up in how you make decisions. But when we made those commitments to see ourselves get to a greater space and state of diversity, we recognized that we wanted to look at our director plus population and also our critical roles. So product, engineering, science roles, and ensuring that we have diverse backgrounds around the table. And I just, if someone's maybe thinking this, I want to reach out into the universe and say, these are goals. These are not about arbitrary quotas. And these goals have allowed us to make meaningful progress to build a global workforce that allows us to create the kind of product and experience that you have, 16 billion people in trees. You can't have just one voice around the table in that. And there's also something really interesting around the kind of push and pull and innovation that happens when people who are not like one another are sitting and having to solve big problems with each other. We tend to work harder when we sit next to people who think differently than us. We want to show up in a way where we are putting our best ideas forward. And so we encourage that while also reminding everyone that not always does aptitude and altitude align. We know that there are brilliant people who have never been given an opportunity, and we are committed to dismantling that space so long as we exist. And then externally, I'll just note, I think it's an important thing to note for folks that maybe haven't heard this, but we did a survey recently that found that more than half, I think approximately 53% of Americans can't name all four grandparents, meaning there's a knowledge gap in key information about more recent family history. We're not talking about three, fourth generation removed. We're talking about grandmother and grandfather. And without having those names, those stories, you can't unlock some things that are really important to the next level of that. And so, if nothing else, we held just one goal up about our purpose and our mission. Here's that 53% that if we're doing our job, we can slice that in half with good intentional work.
What just interesting that survey, when did it splice down based off of maybe age or demographic or anything about what was known and what wasn't known within a particular family?
I mean, it's a great question. I'm happy to follow up. And in fact, we can follow up and share the survey results as well. The link to that It's interesting you raised demographics because there's an ongoing conversation around just generationally how that's showing up, especially and this is speaking of Americans, when we think about how records, let's just say records, not all of us can read in cursive anymore. And so when we're reading records and trying to connect back, it matters that we can read the records that are available as well. But I'm happy to follow up with that to ensure that everyone's understanding what that 53%, what encompasses that percentage.
And it's interesting when you were mentioning too about you're working with different teams, right? When we think about your product teams, your marketing teams, like explain how you come in and kind of just help them with the experience in general.
Yeah, we there's two folds to that. One, we have an incredible marketing team, a marketing team that doesn't lead with their chest out, like we know it all, we'll figure it out on our own, but rather, even just earlier today, it was said to, in front of the company, thank you for your ideas, for your passion, for what inspires you that you're then leaning into our team and asking, have you tried this? Have you thought about this? The reason why I mentioned that is because our purpose is to empower and inspire people to represent all that they are, because we believe that when people can see themselves represented in history, they believe they too can make history. But you can't do any of that if you don't see yourself in the marketing materials, if you don't see yourself across our various channels, if you're not feeling that and seeing that encouragement first before you feel it. You're not going to move. You're not going to have a sense of urgency because you're probably going to tell yourself, there's nothing out there. There's nothing for me there. I know all that there could possibly be to know about my family. Or there, you will be frozen in a bit of guilt around what you might find as well. And so we've done a number of things, but I will say the thing that I'm most I would say proud of, because this team works very hard, we have inclusivity guidelines that lead everything that we do. Internally with our Ancestry teams when it comes to user-generated content to ensure sensitivity and respectfully representing people from around the world. We also have cultural advisory panels as well that review our product and marketing content to encourage that cultural sensitivity that's necessary. Growth and an ability to understand you may get it wrong at times, but how you respond, the authenticity by which you respond, the ability to not say, oh, we meant well versus, yeah, your intent was one thing, the impact was the other. And to sit with the people whose stories we are endeavoring to share so that they can allow us to be students. That has been critical to the cultural advisory panel that several of my colleagues lead. And this year we added advisors who specialize in South Asia, China, Indonesia, in African regions south of the Sahara, all with the purpose of ensuring again that we have this multi-ethnic identity and can increase a sense of belonging across our product. And I'm hoping fervently that you are feeling that as you visit Ancestry time and time again. Folks who tell me, hey, I was a part of it, I was on the Ancestry website a month or two ago, haven't been back. I tell them all the time, go back and see what new egg there is for you to find too.
You mentioned something I hadn't heard before, this culture advisory committee. Is that something internal or external? And then
That's
who's in
internal.
it? Okay.
Yeah, it's internal, but the members, it's internally reviewed, like it's internal members of my colleagues that lead that. However, the members are external to Ancestry. And so best way to I would say it is that we believe and know fervently that we don't have all the greatest ideas under our own hat. And so with experts from outside museums, universities, we've been able to build up our cultural competency, and quite frankly, be very honest about times when we need to go back and be students of the very work we're hoping to create and endeavor.
How large is that committee? Like if it's led by internal folks, but then it includes external members. Just curious about
Yeah.
that. Oh.
We have about over 100 experts on that panel there, and it continues to grow. By very, I would say astute, and I say this because I don't want anyone to pat Ashlee on the back. My colleague Spencer Snow does incredible work in that space, partnering with Jillian McCoy, And they have scoured various industries and spaces. And we also tell our colleagues, if you know someone who is passionate about this space, learned in this space, continues to chart new territories, reach out to our team so that we can chat with them and explore possibilities there. So it's certainly grown since its inception.
Yeah, that's interesting. Me and the circles of genealogists, we're always wondering, like, who are they talking to? So now I kind of have an idea. It's at least one of these groups, this culture advisory committee. Interesting. And so you talked about the guidelines that you have internally. It makes me wonder, when you arrived, what was the landscape like? And was there any sort of resistance or conflict, and how has that grown, and where do you what's ideal for you, and if things were rosy, right?
Yeah, you said if things were rosy.
Maybe they are.
No, look, I tell people all the time, this is, while I say this is without a doubt the most fun I've had in any role, it also comes with, because I'm passionate about it, David, I'm sure you can understand, that means you stay up at night thinking about it. You are trying your very best to figure out, how do we bring more people in? How can we dismantle or demystify things that are confusing or debunk myths? But when I think about the biggest obstacle I faced in this role, I'd have to say, coming in, I joined just over 3 years ago, but have been in this space for over 15 years. It was really, for some people, fear. It was the I think it was a Dr. King quote where he says that he believes that men hate each other because they fear each other, and they fear each other because they don't know each other. And they don't know each other because they don't communicate, and that's because they're separated. We are so separated. I don't care how much of a diverse community you live in. There's an exercise I do in some trainings that I ask people to list their immediate circle, not the people they're related to, but your chosen circle. And generally speaking, people either align on, well, if it's your beliefs, your education and background, sexual orientation, how you were raised, we gravitate to that. But that doesn't make us bad people. It just means that when we come into an organization and we're now sitting next to and trying to solve problems with someone who thinks about the world differently, we are taught to fear that person versus be curious about them. And that fear is something we don't teach children to feel that way, and yet we give ourselves as permission as adults to feel that way. And I would argue it has stifled not just DEI, but genealogy. We know for a number of years the way we thought about what type of family was valuable or worth documenting, or whether or not we needed to cleanse one race and protect it from another, all had a lot to do with fear in that space. And so we, as far as we've come, we certainly have not come as far as we think we want to be. But that fear is something we've labeled here. We've given safe space. We've talked a lot about psychological safety. And we reminded people, you have the right to believe certainly what you want to believe, but working at Ancestry is a privilege. And here are our values. Our values say that we believe everyone deserves the opportunity to learn about their family history. So we're expecting you to innovate with that in mind, with no preconceived notions on building for just one type of family. And that, to me, is quite a responsibility that we take seriously.
No, it's a beautiful answer. And it makes me, when you talk about encouraging to innovate, because you very much are a technology-based company that's looking to innovate. Can you share about just some of the maybe new tools that you have been helping to advise on that maybe have yet to be revealed, or things that have been newly revealed, or whatever you're able to share on the innovation front?
Sure. This has been a really exciting season for us, and I'm hoping some of these releases are not news to a lot of folks, because you hopefully have seen it firsthand. We're constantly, as the global leader in family history and consumer genomics, we are constantly developing innovative ways for For our customers to explore their identity through DNA and unlocking deeper insights into their family history. And earlier this month, Ancestry DNA launched its largest update to date, which will match its DNA customers to more than 3,000 places and populations around the world. To say we're excited is an understatement. It has been a labor of love cross-functionally, and we're excited about it. But what's been most impressive is the reaction. We've seen millions of people come to the site for return, come back, engage, and share their feedback and perspective on that. And as genetic science continues to advance, Ancestry DNA is now able to offer you users a closer look at whether their family originated with increased precision. We can also show that granularity alongside an updated user experience. And just so if you, I don't know if folks are numbers people like myself, but with more individuals incorporated into our ancestral regions, our reference panels have improved substantially. We're now offering 24 new ancestral regions across Europe, West Asia, South and Southeast Asia, Africa, and Africa as well. And that accounting for five retired regions, this update expands the total regions that we have from 88 to 107, which is quite impactful when you think about the experience that folks are having. And so out of the 21 ancestral regions in Africa, 13 now feature content representing 64 ethnic groups, which means you don't just find out that origin, your family origin, you are connected to someone from that region that is telling you more about the culture, the food, the music, to make it more of an immersive experience. And we hope that excites people to learn more. It's just the beginning for us as well. But we think that is, quite frankly, it's getting beyond the screen, and also hopefully it connects people with their why a bit more. I say a lot here that, no one's origin should begin in bondage, that we have enough technology, information, records to get you beyond that. And so what a tremendous opportunity to, quite frankly, we're not seeking to rewrite, but to go to the front of the book and keep writing, add more pages. It's long overdue.
The ancestry updates, when they first were happening, it was for me, I rarely looked at it, honestly. It was like, oh, I'm now 23% this versus 22. But the most recent updates have been interesting. And I think it's definitely been a lot of hoo-ha in the genealogist circle, especially in Facebook groups when these things come out. Everyone's like, go look. And it has been interesting. And I think for me, initially there was a thought where, well, why do they keep updating? Are they wrong? But now it's more so, well, it's an evolution. Like, this is still a very new product, and what they're doing is pretty much revolutionary. I think for the most part, we were talking earlier, many of the genealogists that are listening right now, especially on the older end, this whole process didn't even exist for them. It was courthouses. It was, family Bibles and stuff. And so this has opened up a whole new door. And because it's a brand new technology in a way, it's just going to be an evolution of of what you're doing. Quite thankful for it. When I think about what you just described and your just enthusiasm about the work, tell me a little bit about just what came with you, your experience from the Obama administration. I mean, I imagine that was a lot during the Obama year. I mean, that's national politics and governing and all that stuff, and this is a private sector company. But I imagine that there was a lot of transferable skills for you between these two experiences.
Yes, absolutely. I mean, if you allow me, it's hard for me to talk about my time in the Obama administration without backing up a bit and just sharing how I got there. And by that I mean, I'm the eldest of three daughters. My parents, Michael and Vanessa, met when they were little teenagers and fell in love, and just thank God they're still there, right? In love and with us. And I mentioned that because my parents were blue collar workers. They're now earned their retirement and are just goo-goo gaga over their grandchildren, as you should be in these years. And I say that because when I got the call, up to join the administration, look, I called my parents right away, straight away. And I called my nana too, because you don't make big decisions without your parents and your grandma too. And I called them because I wanted them to know two things. I just graduated law school, took the bar. I was trying to figure out what's next. You've been there, Dave. You were like, what is it? If it's not lined up, you're like, I got to figure it out, right? These loans are calling me one day real quick. And I said, well, I got the offer to come in, but here's the catch. It's not a paying role. And I was calling them to say, like, I don't think I got this in the savings to do. And my mom and my dad, they were on speakerphone, like together. They said, no, we'll figure it out. We'll figure it out. You don't say no to this. We'll figure it out. And then I called my nana and I said, told her the same thing. And I said, well, mom, dad said, we're going to figure it out. And she said, well, of course we will. And by the way, you are not the first person in our family to work at the White House. And I thought, well, I've never known that. What does that mean? And she said, well, you have an uncle. And she told me a bit about how he certainly didn't have a desk job, but worked as a courier in between the White House and other government buildings. And she said, look, when he was working in that space, there was no, opportunity for him to have a badge and sit at the desk that you are going to be invited to sit in. And so you say yes to this, no matter how you enter, because the way you leave will not be the way you come into that space. And she was right. So were my parents in that same regard. I served in administration for almost 7 years and had a variety of roles, including White House liaison. Just things that being from North Nashville, from the South, I know I've got a little bit of twang. Somebody on the call can hear it a little bit. There's a lot that is presumed of our aptitude based on where we come from. And yet, I also know, David, I am not a unicorn. And so every time I enter a room, I know that every table I sit at, the seats are either going to be multiplied or divided based on the impact I make in that space. And so I can't afford to sit in splendor of looking around and being in awe of where I am. I got to make some meaningful progress. And that's exactly how I thought about that, what can be, quite frankly, a very short time in federal government service. From the gentleman I met in West Virginia, I'll never forget him, who approached me at the end of a town hall to shake my hand and express his thanks and his willingness to chat more about government programs. And to the Black trans woman I met in Nevada, who told me that the information our team shared that day was going to help her find housing she sorely needed. When we're in roles of influence or able to be a strong contributor, we have the opportunity to do the type of good work that results in positive generational change. And that's the same for the kind of work, it's just a different sector. Being in DEI and corporate America means that I'm at tables where we have to think about mitigating bias so that someone deserving of a promotion gets it. And they're in a space where they get that stretch assignment. They're no longer thought of after the fact, but in front of the fact. And so this is tremendously important work that is much more than alphabet soup of just saying the letters DEI. We do ourselves a disservice if we can't get beyond the letters and start thinking about the lives that are going to be changed.
I love the story about your uncle, and you didn't know this, right? That
No
was new
clue.
information to you. You
No.
know, there's so many family stories that are just not really told or shared, especially in certain demographics of our country. They just don't, people don't tell these stories. And when I think about, in Ancestry, there's so many research tools, right, that we can all utilize, and new ones that keep coming up left and right, and different databases and all that. Explain a little bit about your role in either helping identify new databases or putting on the radar that, hey, we need to scan these documents over here. It would be helpful to this group of people over here. I mean, do you have those type of conversations? Like, what does that look like?
Yeah, we work quite a bit. My team works very closely with a number of teams that are our content records team. They are incredible. They are constantly scouring not just the places we know where records exist, but having the conversations and earning the trust of communities and spaces that will, we hope, lead us to new discoveries, right? And we We say a lot here, and it's something I hope that is a part of my legacy, that trust is earned and dropped, lost in buckets. And so when we're going to a community, let's say, HBCUs, and as a Bison myself, a Howard Law graduate, Howard's not just going to let you in because you say, look, we've got a Bison on our employees, one of our employees. They need to know what you plan to do with the records. What's the intention? Will this be allowed? Others have access to it. And there's a reason why my colleagues and others in this space need to understand the history of the mistrust. Like, there's trust that has been lost, that generationally, before I got to Ancestry, if you are a Black person in this country, you've learned a lot about not just Henrietta Lacks, Mrs. Lacks, and the Tuskegee Airmen. You know that there's a reason why we ask more questions before we're willing to make one move. And that's because of the things that have happened. And so we work really closely with that team, to understand not just their roadmap, but how we will garner the kind of necessary trust in along the way. And then, quite frankly, how we're going to empower the next generation of history makers as well. For the last 3 years, we've had a scholarship program at HBCUs, Hispanic serving institutions, and tribal colleges and universities, because we believe that wherever we go to recruit, so should our investment in the students. And each time we ask them, what history do you want to make? What history do you want to uncover? What do you hope, records that are out there that maybe we need to be aware of? And they have taught us so much. I mean, if you want to know something, ask a young person and close your mouth, because they'll tell you. It's about whether or not you listen. And these scholars have tremendously, they've helped us quite a bit, to a point where this year we were able to triple our investment in these schools, all because we want to empower that next generation.
Your comment about databases and HBCUs, it brought up for me personally. I had an aunt recently pass away, and no, she was the first one in our family to graduate from college. She graduated from North Carolina A&T, and no one could find out when she graduated except for me. I pulled up her senior yearbook in Ancestry's database, found her picture, found the clubs that she was in, and it was because it was scanned. It was all on Ancestry. But your comment about Henrietta Lacks, it brings up a point about trust in DNA. There's a lot in the news about certain organizations that are out there that have a lot of people's DNA. Ancestry does as well. Share with us just the process or the thought process from Ancestry on the having so much information about someone personally, and what responsibility that means, and how that's used and not used, and especially when we look at it from, like, as you mentioned earlier, ancestry and genealogy in general has a twisted past when it comes to race and the purity of certain races. Like, what is Ancestry's approach to just having this responsibility that I think is kind of vast?
Yeah, I think you're right, David. It's the number one question I answer, especially in when I'm in spaces of marginalized groups and communities. Marginalized people and communities is the number one question. And to be very frank with you, I mean, if I didn't know how high we prioritize customer privacy, I couldn't be in this organization. We use industry standard security practices to store DNA samples, DNA test results, and other personal data provided to us. But even more, I think, paramount to all of that is we believe customers should always maintain control of their DNA data. And Ancestry also, we do not voluntarily share customer personal information with law enforcement unless compelled to by valid legal process, such as a court order or search warrant. And so that we taking this seriously, but also it's one thing, and you can, easily visit the Ancestry and type in Privacy Center, and there is enough bedtime reading for everybody on this call to pay attention to how much we think about this to the very letter. But deeper than that is how we communicate it in communities. And so, for instance, we held a community film screening in Atlanta at the National Center for Human and Civil Rights. And we opened up the mic at the end of that conversation for questions from the audience. and had members of our team there in this group, this very beautifully representative group of Atlanta, that question was raised. And the lady said, "I feel comfort now, and I'm excited about going on this journey." And so instead of being arrogant about, well, you know, and we'll take good care of it, we have to walk with people and answer the question more than once with care and with thoughtfulness, because there are reasons and other bad practice and bad actors that have caused people to, quite frankly, not engage on a journey that could very much change the trajectory of their lives. And you know, there's something you mentioned, David, that I just want to know. You even hinted to it. The family history research, even if we just step aside from DNA for a moment, can be challenging for Black Americans due to the long history of slaves in the US and the lack of documentation about those who were enslaved. And so whether we're talking about DNA or family history, this is not a straight and narrow, you know, a linear road. And for other communities, there's additional obstacles to it. But you know, recently, the Articles of Enslavement is a good example of a recent release in June, where we released a collection of approximately, I believe it's about 38,000 newspaper articles related to enslaved people in the United States from 1788 to about 1867. And the truth is, we found that that is a good stepping stone to beginning the DNA journey if someone is able to first start on the family history side of this work. And so the stepping stones are immense, they're important, but we also are more than willing and committed to walking with our customers. We're not going anywhere either.
Yeah, it's definitely a concept that is talked about a lot. But I will say personally, when people ask which provider to use, I do refer them to Ancestry because of the fact that I do have control over what's there, especially now and forever. At least I feel that way based off of what I've read and what you're now saying. But I do think your point too about not just DNA, but family history in general. There's you guys now have so much information about people in general, about just the lives, the very details of people's lives. I'm just curious, what is Ancestry's their how do they feel about having so much information, not just DNA, but so much information about individuals? And it's almost I view Ancestry almost like a utility at this point when it comes to just database, almost like a library. And libraries are free, right? Public libraries are all free, but Ancestry has grown to this level. I'm not saying you guys should be free, but it's venturing on something like that as far as the responsibility to the greater public. I mean, are there conversations about that with Ancestry? Just a general like the access issue and all that.
Well, first, let me just acknowledge. I don't know if members are our board on here, but David, you're not going to get me to say to make this whole platform free. I'm gonna make it real plain. But let me be clear about what we've done thus far and what's in the works, because you're absolutely right. You know, we do have the world's largest, most distinguished collection of over 60 billion records from 88 countries, and also the world's largest consumer DNA database with more than 25 million people. But the incredible piece of this, you know, as much as that is exciting, and we acknowledge that, quite frankly, we see that as something that is a privilege. We scanned our 1 billionth record into newspapers.com just a few weeks ago, and was just celebrated it earlier today in our town hall. But we've also made commitments to, like, how history needs to be preserved. To create a more connected and inclusive future, we prioritize how we give and how we devote our funding to that work. So we've devoted $3 million by 2025 to preserving history that is at risk of being lost or forgotten. And since establishing this goal in 2021, we've made more than 8.4 million records available to everyone at no cost. And we are constantly looking at that as we look to build on that. Thanks to Jillian McCoy and the team, it has grown exponentially. We also have Ancestry Classroom, and more for more than a decade, We've provided educators free at no cost at all, the resources necessary to help students find their personal place in history. And to date, we've provided more than 11 million students around the world with free access to Ancestry. And we're also a proud partner with Facing History and ourselves. And I mentioned this just to say, for us, that is the beginning of this work. That should be, if we talk in a year from now, you should see that exponentially growing, because there's more that we need to do. It's the stories as well. It's the opportunity to share and give access to others. And we're also really excited with the partnerships we have with HBCUs, HSIs, and tribal colleges and universities, where we donate ancestry access every single year so that those students can begin to tell their stories and capture the stories of those before us. And so we are always open to the suggestion and feedback. If someone says, hey, that's good, that's two-thirds of it, where's the other third? Reach out to me, please, and talk to me. Give me your ideas, because there is no shiny penny over here where we think we've figured it all out. We can only do this right if we have good partners, like folks who care about this.
It was always a really great tool. Now I just feel like it's so massive. I feel like it's hard to ignore. Your work is one is it's necessary. Diversity, equity, the space that you work in. I'm just curious if you can maybe advise some of the people in the audience if they're encountering some tough family history dynamics, especially on the lines of like race, ethnicity. Like, for instance, I found a slave owner in my family tree. How do I reckon with that as someone who's, four generations removed, right?
Yeah, I think I don't think you're, that person is alone. And in fact, I would argue that what usually keeps either prevents people from beginning or stops them in their tracks is a discovery or the fear of a discovery that is going to, quite frankly, leave them feeling it with a sense of guilt. There's a quote that says, it says, if you seek comfort at the expense of truth, you get neither. And we think of history in that same giving unadulterated access to history in the same way. The Articles of Enslavement release that I mentioned that came out in June is a good example of we're not just saying, here's the collection, go forward, but we realize this collection documents the dehumanizing nature of slavery and demonstrates how slavery was normalized in the United States. And family history, we know it is a bridge, yes, but it also can create kind of that pit in your stomach. But that's not where it ends. I mean, we could talk about our work with, quite frankly, releasing a number of Holocaust records, as well as our work with the Erizo Project as well, as it relates to 125,000 persons of Japanese descent who are unjustly imprisoned between December 1942 and 1948. I mention all of this because if we are not careful, diligent, and thoughtful about how we share history, when we share it, and the courage by which we share it, right? Now, we don't cower when we say 125,000 people, but rather we say it with our chest out front because these were lives that were stifled, that were impugned. We rob the next generation here in that space, having those stories. And so we talk a lot about the fact that history is not linear. It is not always clean. It is also not easy to hear, and yet it is necessary because we've seen the mistakes we make if we don't share history in its most purest form. And the truth you think you're getting, you actually aren't getting at all. It's momentary, comfort altogether. You didn't have real comfort. You had the illusion of it, and quite frankly, you're passing down stories that that will just harm others in the future. And so we're really proud of the partnerships we have, for instance, with the National Archives Partnership and the National Archives and Records Administration, because we're digitizing, indexing, and publishing tens of millions re of records, all with the purpose of making sure people can have access to it, And then giving them the technical assistance to know how to get started, how to get beyond a boulder. If you've ever engaged in family history or records, you know you're going to hit inevitably a bit of a boulder. The question is, do you close your computer or your phone or that book, or did you keep persevering because someone was there to help you? And that's our role. That's when we step in.
With time, I'm going to start taking a few questions out of our chat box. I'm going to ask you. So for everyone listening, if you have questions, start to add them into the chat and I will try to get to them if we have time. The first question is just about the individual Deborah Nix. She writes that she's on Ancestry, but she's also on storied.com, where she was able to post and share her first story. And she was wondering if Ancestry was looking into doing something like that or broadening the story element beyond the research.
Yeah, no, that's a great question. Storytelling has been at the forefront of our product team and the work that they are not just, passionate about, but we don't want to just offer storytelling in a way that is something you could have done without our website. We think that we have a really unique and opportunity to help you tell a story that reaches the world. We also think that it's really exciting the way that our new technology is going to allow you to capture stories without having to necessarily write it all. But oral history, we know, is the earliest form, some of the earliest forms of storytelling as well. And quite frankly, it's the stories that I remember the most are the stories where I've sat next to someone or they've trusted me enough to share what's impactful for them. So yes, we are absolutely zeroed in on storytelling, but we're also thinking about that in an accessible way. How do we ensure that people of all backgrounds have an ability to share their story, different languages, and the like? So our colleagues around the world are also working on this when we think about the expansion to new international markets too.
Your comment about languages brings up this my thought about AI and is what is Ancestry doing with AI? Because I know there's the AI platforms that will translate for you now automatically based off of foreign language documents. They'll translate automatically for you, decipher and all that. I mean, is Ancestry going down that road with AI or what?
Yeah, we walk. Yeah, I think any tech company that tells you they're not paying close attention to and surveying AI is either not being truthful with you or not is behind the eight ball. But our thought process on AI is not how it can take the driver's seat, but how it can enhance the experience of our customers to unlock the discoveries in meaningful ways. And I think a good example of that is the way we used AI to analyze 26,000 newspapers to identify articles that mentioned the enslaved. It allowed this articles of enslavement released in June to be much more fruitful. They were then those records were then indexed by humans to ensure accuracy. And the result of this is the free collection that we now have that has over 180,000 formerly enslaved people in the United States. We couldn't have done that with the speed that we did it without AI, but we will not replace human indexing in the touch and care of a human being who also has a family and understands it's important to get this right.
Well, I will say I love someone who's already indexed something, but I also find myself correcting incorrect
Hear you.
indexes along Ancestry. So I think both is good. I think both are necessary. Next question I have is from Andre Kearns. He's one of our NGS board members and chair of the DEI committee. He says, what's Ancestry's initiative you are the most excited about that will help expand to new audiences?
I love that question. I could say a lot, but Andre asked for one. I've been in organizations where DEI training has been required or mandatory. And I personally am just not a fan of that. I believe if you, much like eating your vegetables as a kid, you may have done it, but you did it reluctantly. You didn't really like Brussels sprouts until you explored them on your own and came to it. So too is, I think, the whole exploration of DEI, of inclusion, of becoming an inclusive leader. We've offered to date four immersive inclusive leadership trainings, each of them a little bit different. And we Always extend personalized invites to the employees. We have a set number of seats, but we tell them we're inviting you because we believe you can be a positive disruptor in our culture. And we invite them, we loop their manager in, we make sure the senior leadership team is aware as well. But if they tell me no at the end of the day, David, I don't loop in their manager to go, okay, this person said no. I say, okay, we'll add you to a future list, or you can tell me if you're just not ready for it. What we found is that the people who lean in, even reluctantly, right, that they say, oh, Ashlee, what do you have me going into? They come out of that with an immense amount of not just accountability, but energy in ways they haven't had before. And so we just had a class go through an immersive leadership experience that is stirring up a lot of conversation around the water cooler about what we want to do with our culture. And I'm excited about it, but I'm also happy that people are coming to it on their own versus being pushed, pulled, or dragged to this work. And it is work, by the way, this journey we're on, the culture we want to build. Quite frankly, the global product we are hoping to build out and expand to global markets, all of that takes willing participants who are on the team, not someone that we just threw the jersey on and said, you must do X. And that is what I'm most proud of. It's the commitments and the way people are holding each other accountable. I couldn't have planted those seeds any better than the way they're doing it on their own.
Is there a plan to do something similar for its users and not just internal employees?
We hadn't talked about that. What would that look like? What, tell me more. What do you think?
I think people that are in this space that want to learn more, but learn it in a more meaningful way, especially when it comes to the area in which you're specializing in and we're talking about when it comes to diversity in the genealogy space, like having like a master class on what this looks like to users, maybe. I don't know. I think I wouldn't be surprised if there's a audience for user programming on that front. I know
I
I
think
would
you,
say.
yeah, I was going to say, I think at least within this call alone, we'd have folks who are interested in it. The interesting part is all of our training to date has been, all of this type of training has been in person, and it's been very small group, no more than 20, 25 people. It is titled a cohort because you go into this together, you experience things. One person messaged me after the first day and said, I am exhausted. But then on the second day, she said, but I'm so glad I did this at the same time. And so I think as long as we have people who are committed to this work, you know, for us, we're trying to get the kind of necessary ambassadors on their teams to move things forward. But we also need those external partners as well, David. So I think you're spot on right about that.
Yeah, our one of our board members, Andre, he says, feel free to reach out to us. We can
Happy.
support that endeavor. Absolutely. A sponsored event. There's a unique question here from Susanna Santiago. She says, I'm from Brazil, and here we don't have a culture of genealogical research for citizenship purposes only. She says, I do my own research, but I really lack references from researchers for enslaved ancestors, and I'm here to learn more. What can you share with Susanna and Bill?
Yeah, I think that's an important point. I'll say this on twofold. It has been a learning, a quick learning exercise, but one that we are careful in engaging in is learning that the very, you know, for some a hobby, some a passion, some like a personal mission, and then some a job. Family history is not across the globe understood or even engaged in at the same way and level, and therefore the resources are lacking as a result. Our team, led by Sumankar, looks at international expansion, but we actually are working with partners, and I regret that I can't say like in this region, in that region, so much as we are focused on the spaces where we know, not that there's necessarily a family history bug already, but there is a strong appreciation for family and preservation and storytelling, which is hard to find anywhere, not to find around the globe. But Suzanne, if you want to reach out to me directly, there's members of our team I think that could be helpful. Because what we found also is that as we expand globally, we've had to make sure our technology keeps up with the needs of those communities too. And that's something we're working in tandem with.
Susanna, one of Ashley's colleagues is in the chat box. I think she'll share an email with you. So there you go. Great, great question. Another one, interesting, not interesting, but question I should have asked. When we look at DEI, what does that, how's that defined? The person asking here, Ann Thom, says, is it wondering if that includes age and disability? But how are you guys defining that, and what's it look like?
I love that question. When it's hard to define diversity if in a way that you're not measuring or you're not giving people a way to self-disclose. And so it took us meaningful several months, but we launched a global self-ID tool earlier this year to allow our employees voluntarily to self-disclose everything from their veteran status, disability, sexual orientation, gender expression, and gender identity, all with the purpose of one, letting them know, and we remind them of the importance of privacy. There's no list of sorts, but this has allowed us to make more intentional programming that thinks about our employees. It also allows us to understand where certain teams are maybe higher in one demographic and lower in the other. And that could at times impact our ability to innovate, to think about others who are not around the table. And so we are absolutely looking at those metrics across the space. I will say though, because I think there was a note around age, we do not currently, we don't necessarily say millennials here, Gen X there. However, I do think it's important to know, because I think what our colleague here in the chat is noting, you know, there is generational friction happening across various industries when you have five, almost now new, it's going to be six generations working in the workplace together. And so we're not going to bury our head in the sand. And tech has a way of, at times, being very generous to one age group and not to the other. And so we're committed to mitigating that bias too.
You know, it makes you wonder, do you know demographic data about your users? Like, do you know the age, like the average age of the user and all that?
Yeah, I don't I can't say that we don't so much as I don't have that lens and that view. And I think it would be not truthful of me to say, oh no, we don't. And then we say, yeah, we do. But I have never seen a view of that myself.
Well, that is all we have time for. This was great, Ashley. I
Thank
hopefully
you,
I
David.
wasn't too inquisitive for you. I
You were
think
great. Thank you.
this was super informative. I know our members appreciated it. I thoroughly appreciate it. This was so much fun. I'm going to hand it off to Matt before I close it out. He has a few announcements about future programs, but this was great.
Thank you.
Ashlee and David, thank you both so much for being here and for such a great conversation. We really do appreciate it. And thank you to all of our attendees who were here tonight. Also, greatly appreciated for you to be here. Just have a few announcements that we want to make for you. Our wouldn't be a NGS event if we didn't let you know about the upcoming Family History Conference, which will be held Memorial Day weekend, May 23rd through 26th in Louisville, Kentucky. Tales and Trails, the next NGS Family History Conference in person in Louisville, Kentucky. So put that on your calendars. And we will be hosting the next GRIP Genealogy Institute next summer. We will be virtual from the 23rd through 27th of June, 2025, and in Pittsburgh from the 13th through 18th of July. The course listings are already up on the GRIP website at grip.ngsgenealogy.org, so you can take a look at that. Registration will open this winter. Our new book, Forensic Genealogy, Theory and Practice, is in its final production stages and will be shipping this fall. This is the newest book from the National Genealogical Society, written by Michael Ramage and Catherine Damaris with some co-authors. Look for that on our website where you can pre-order it for shipping later this fall. We also have available two new Research in the States guides for Maine and Hawaii, to opposite ends of the coastal spectrum of the United States. So if you are researching in an ocean of information, certainly reach out and order either the Hawaii or Maine Research in the States guides. And with that, just want to also mention our Family Matters program, a project of Vivid Picks and the National Genealogical Society, which is a community outreach toolkit for genealogy organizations. So if you're a member of a genealogy organization, a leader in your local society, a person involved with your family association, please reach out to us and we'll tell you more about the Family Matters toolkit for genealogy organizations. And with that, once again, Ashlee, thank you so much. David, thank you as always for being an exceptional host of Culture Conversations. And we look forward to seeing all of you at the next one in about 3 months. Thank you all
Yep.
and good night.
Thank you, everyone. And we are putting our slate of programs together for next year for our speakers. As you know, Culture Conversations happens once a quarter. Can't happen more than that because I still have a full-time job. But you'll hear more about our next speaker, which will most likely be in February or March. With that, thank you, everyone. Thank you, Ashlee. We will be in touch.